I'm Jeff Lohr from CBS Saturday Morning. Welcome to The Dish. Coffee lovers, rejoice. Today we travel far and wide to find the perfect cup of Joe. In Brooklyn, we meet a self-described activist entrepreneur shedding light on the rich culture and flavor of Vietnamese coffee. And we visit a San Francisco cafe famous for their Irish coffee. But first, come with us as we follow the enchanting aroma of espresso all the way to Italy, where Seth Doane hit the streets of Naples to experience the perfect pour.
The vibrant southern Italian city of Naples seems to run on espresso.
It's a very exciting city.
Is any of that due to its love for coffee?
Yes, this is packed in here. It's like a temple.
And coffee here is like a religion. Cafe Gambrinus was established before Italy was, back when Naples was a kingdom.
But talking about coffee, you know, it's just like talking about the pizza, you know. It's part of our tradition.
And
it's part
Marcello Uzzi offers high-end tours of his city and says this is a regular stop. Espresso, simply called coffee here, takes about 30 seconds to brew, a little less than that to drink.
Okay. Please, next time, take your time.
Moreno Faino works for Italian coffee powerhouse Illy.
How many cups of coffee do you think you have in a day working here?
Roughly 10.
He says it's a real shame to simply knock it back.
Think about what happened before the 50 beans were selected. How many people was involved in preparing the right cup of espresso? And then you have to appreciate the balance, the right level of bitterness and the sourness and the sweetness.
Uno medio, uno piccolo.
There's so much to know that Illy developed a university of coffee at its headquarters in the northeastern port city of Trieste.
There are more than 140 rules that can affect the final result in the cup.
16 grammi.
Yes, rules. Barista Stefano Giannini is a sort of coffee professor at Illy.
What exactly is espresso? If you consider from Latin, expressum, it means under pressure. This is the way we extract the coffee.
Italians invented this highly calibrated method of preparation. But first, the beans must be roasted and ground just right. An art in itself.
Illy imports coffee beans from about 24 different countries and at any given time has around 100,000 bags of it on hand. That is enough to brew more than 650 million cups of coffee.
That seems just about enough to fuel the city of Naples. Which brings us back.
Hi, Seth.
Hey.
How are you?
To Marcello Uzzi.
This is your local spot?
Yes, this is it.
There is a bit of competition here among different Italian cities. Who has the best coffee?
How can you compete with our coffee? It's impossible.
Cheers.
Indeed, espresso is brewed under pressure, with a fair dose of passion and pride.
Up next, a taste of Vietnamese coffee via a Brooklyn roastery. Stay with us. We often associate coffee coming from powerhouse producers like Brazil or Colombia. But did you know that Vietnam is actually the second largest grower of coffee beans in the world? Nancy Chen met an entrepreneur on a mission to give these lesser known beans a little more buzz.
Something's brewing on the first floor of this building, tucked among the warehouses of industrial Brooklyn. The complex and caffeinated flavors of Vietnam, carefully roasted to their chocolate caramelized peak under the watchful eye of Sarah Nguyen.
Oh, this is heavy.
It's 30 pounds.
Okay.
There you go. Pour it all in.
Pour it all in.
All of it.
As the CEO of Nguyen Coffee Supply, Nguyen says timing is everything. Just 1 minute can make all the difference for these beans.
Ooh.
That does smell really good.
You smell the sugar, it's caramelizing. Now the sugar is starting to really pop. So we're currently now at a 410 degrees Fahrenheit. So when it's hotter, it's developing much rapidly at this point.
Yeah,
Checking because every 5-10 seconds will change the profile of the bean.
Nguyen knows the importance of striking while the bean is hot. When the self-described activist entrepreneur started the first specialty Vietnamese coffee company in the United States, coffee from Vietnam was both nowhere and everywhere.
I didn't know that Vietnam was the second largest grower of coffee beans in the world.
Yes. And honestly, Nancy, I think it's because of lack of transparency.
How so?
So when Vietnamese coffee leaves Vietnam, the label doesn't say product of Vietnam or Vietnamese coffee beans, it just says coffee.
With only Brazil outpacing it, Vietnam exported about 3.5 billion pounds of coffee in 2020 alone, most of it mixed into commercial grade blends. And while Vietnam is the world's largest producer of the Robusta bean, the vast majority of high-end specialty coffee is created from a different species, the Arabica bean.
What are some of the misperceptions about Vietnamese coffee?
People wouldn't use words such as cheap, disgusting, nasty, rubber tires to describe the Robusta bean. But really, that experience or those descriptions, it's really rooted in the production, not the variety. If you've pushed an entire industry into an instant cheap coffee production, you're gonna get a lower quality product because you're selling for a cheaper product.
A perception and process roasters like Nguyen and others are trying to change by embracing the Robusta bean.
Robusta beans have up to double the caffeine content of Arabica. Robusta beans also have up to 60% less fats and sugars than Arabica. So what that means from a flavor experience is you'll get a much more dark chocolatey, nutty, bold, and low acidic coffee with Robusta beans.
Nguyen Coffee Supply is part of a burgeoning shift as more specialty Vietnamese coffee companies open around the country.
Well, I think we're in the very first early stages of Robusta as a specialty beverage.
Jonathan Morris, the author of Coffee, A Global History, says much of Arabica's appeal has been in how it's processed, with Robusta left out of the picture.
What we're beginning to see is, well, what happens if we try those things with Robusta? Will that make a bit of a difference? Will that create some specialty beverage?
And with a coffee history spanning 500 years, Morris calls the increased awareness a new mindset in approaching that morning cup of joe.
This is a lot of thought to put into a cup of something that you normally drink when you're not thinking that clearly yet.
Yeah, there's a little thought involved, there's a little work involved, but it pays off. It pays off for you both in terms of what you taste and in terms generally, hopefully, of what you've achieved by your purchase. And I think that is something that is becoming more and more important to consumers.
For Nguyen, it wasn't just the mass-produced Vietnamese coffee that left a bitter taste in her mouth, but how the farmers themselves are impacted.
Vietnamese coffee historically and currently has always really been pushed into the instant coffee market or the cheaper commodity coffee market. And because they don't have visibility representation, they can't really advocate for better.
That inequality became a driving force in starting the company. Both of Nguyen's parents fled Vietnam as refugees after the war, but most of her family still lives there today. A 2016 trip changed the course of her life when the then documentary maker connected with a farmer and family friend. Their idea, to celebrate Vietnamese coffee by cultivating better beans.
My producing partner and other farmers I talked to, they're like, how come we can't be a part of specialty coffee? Because the industry kept saying you don't belong. And so he had never actually exported to the United States. He felt so proud that his coffee beans made it to America.
Today, the beans roasted here are shipped to all 50 states. The company says their revenue has grown by 24 times in just 2 years. Nguyen says she now partners with three farms, paying workers a higher rate for the more labor-intensive process. She's also hoping to import Vietnamese coffee culture, a slow-paced ritual influenced by French colonization, one in appreciation of every last drop.
In Vietnam, you actually eat breakfast first, and then you go to a coffee shop or a cafe stand, you have your coffee alone, like it is its own moment.
The coffee is traditionally made as a single serving using a Vietnamese coffee press known as a fin filter and served with sweetened condensed milk.
I love how easy it goes down.
Smooth,
yes,
right?
Yes, it's very, very smooth.
While the company continues to roast and refine the flavors of Vietnamese coffee, Nguyen goes beyond the drink.
It wasn't about the coffee. I mean, it is, but it was really about this mission for me to bring visibility and representation to such a historically marginalized community and one that had been completely rendered invisible for its massive contributions to the global coffee experience. Like, I felt like there was an injustice there for me to write through developing our own supply chain and then, of course, through storytelling and connecting people and bringing people together through coffee.
A community spanning thousands of miles, getting together over a cup of coffee.
We stay in Brooklyn for our next caffeine caper, where Jim Axelrod discovered something special brewing in the back room of a bodega.
In the shadow of the Manhattan Bridge in Brooklyn, Khalid Sharafi is restocking his supply of Colombian beans for the coffee bar inside the grocery store he runs with his cousin, Omar Haimed.
One black, one cream and sugar.
You guys have lots of people coming in here, right?
Right.
To the coffee bar right up at the front?
Yeah.
And they're drinking Colombian, right?
Yeah.
Yes. That coffee?
But when it comes to filling their own cups, forget the coffee bar.
No, we have a secret place.
A secret place?
Speakeasy.
A coffee speakeasy.
Yeah.
And in their backroom coffee speakeasy, where they brew it old school, you can forget the Colombian beans as well.
What do you drink in the back room?
Yemeni coffee.
Omar and Khalid are from Yemen, which is also home, they say, to the world's best coffee.
Yeah, Yemen coffee is the grandfather of all coffees.
How old is the tradition of coffee drinking in Yemen?
So the coffee start in the middle of 14th century.
Ibrahim Al-Hasbani is an eighth generation Yemeni coffee merchant.
Low acid.
Low acid. Yes.
So it's not gonna bother your stomach.
Doesn't have aftertaste.
And there's a natural sweetness.
Yes.
Do you think that is because of the soil or the sun or the kind of water?
All of this is makes the Yemeni coffee special.
He estimates there are as many as 5,000 Yemeni-owned bodegas in New York City. Just about everyone with a back room where they keep the good stuff.
So if I walked into their bodega and said, can I get a cup of Yemeni coffee, what would they say?
To sell Yemeni coffee? No, they said, we don't have. But if you're friends with them, maybe they're gonna give from the back.
Take the bodega Monif Ziad runs in East Harlem.
You order your coffee?
Where, sure enough.
She wants black iced coffee, this is for you, right?
It's Colombian up front. But in the back,
this is all Yemeni coffee.
It's all Yemeni coffee.
Ziad keeps half a dozen different varieties in his back room, brought by friends and family visiting from Yemen. Some more coarsely ground, others not as dark. One so mellow it doesn't need milk, another so strong it'll knock your socks off.
Like, you know, instead of to do double shot from Starbucks or from Dunkin' Donuts, you just use one shot from this.
No sugar, no milk.
There's no sugar,
nothing,
no milk.
Yeah.
Just black.
Just straight black.
So if the Yemeni coffee is top shelf.
Oh, it's different.
That's off the charts.
Yeah.
Why not sell it up front? A civil war, drought, and spiking shipping costs have sent Yemeni coffee prices soaring. Particularly problematic for Al-Hasbani, one of the few to try taking it from the back room to the front counter, opening up Kawa House, a chain of Yemeni coffee shops.
What's it cost for you to bring in a shipment of Yemeni coffee beans?
The last shipment cost me around $400,000.
Wait. Your last shipment of Yemeni coffee cost you $400,000?
Yes.
If you were to get the same shipment, same size, of Colombian beans, what would that cost you?
$60,000.
Which is why, for the most part, Yemeni coffee is not for the pour and go crowd.
Oh. All right, $350.
And so for now, just about every Yemeni selling coffee will keep stocking the Colombian up front to make a better living and continue to drink the good stuff in the back to make a better life.
It's luxury. It's not daily basis coffee, for now.
But for you, is it?
Yes.
We'll have to check your ID before serving up this next story. We head to California for a signature coffee cocktail This is The Dish. What could be more decadent and delicious than fresh brewed coffee topped off with a splash of whiskey and a dash of cream? John Blackstone visits the Buena Vista Cafe in San Francisco to see how they mastered the iconic Irish coffee.
With cable cars running past its door, the Buena Vista Cafe, opened in 1916, is a San Francisco institution. And for over 40 years, it's had the same bartender who's been making the same drink that made the Buena Vista famous.
How many Irish coffees have you made in 41 years?
It's a guesstimate. They say 4 to 5 million. I just take their word for it. I didn't count them.
If anyone knows the story of how Irish coffee first came to America back in 1952, it's Paul Nolan.
Yeah, the original recipe came from Ireland, the inventor. He gave the recipe to the beat writer for the Chronicle, Stanton Delaplane.
So Stanton Delaplane, who brought Irish coffee from Ireland to here, he was a newspaper guy.
He was a reporter.
So is it proper for me to say that maybe a news reporter is the originator of Irish coffee in America rather than a bartender?
Well, let's just say he conveyed the recipe to the right source.
That recipe, two sugars, hot coffee, and of course, the active ingredient.
This is about an ounce and a third here of Irish whiskey.
Then the finishing touch, carefully floating a layer of heavy cream on top, an irresistible combination.
And you taste the whiskey.
It's dangerous to do this with a mustache.
Usually we're giving an extra napkin when people have mustaches.
And nobody drinks only one.
Bob Freeman admits he wasn't really an Irish coffee fan when he bought the Buena Vista back in 2001.
At the time, they were doing about 250,000 Irish coffees a year.
A 250,000 Irish coffees a year?
Yeah, around that number, yes.
You made this because this was a sound business decision, not because of any romantic idea about Irish coffee.
No, I like it. It's a wonderful drink. Matter of fact, now I love it.
And much loved by locals and tourists alike.
There's no experience like being at this table or at that bar and having an Irish coffee at the Buena Vista.
Every week, a truckload of Irish whiskey arrives at the cafe, enough to go through 100 bottles a day. They say the Buena Vista is the world's largest single consumer of Irish whiskey. Not surprising, given the way Paul Nolan pours the stuff.
And just in case I didn't give everybody what they deserve, I always add a little bit more.
For more stories like these and live coverage of breaking news 24/7, stream us right here on CBS News. I'm Jeff Glore. We'll see you next time for another helping of The Dish.
This episode of The Dish is sponsored by Prudential. Plan, invest, insure. Retire with Prudential.